Good evening, everybody, and welcome to our Community Redevelopment Agency Board Meeting of the City of Boynton Beach. Today is Tuesday, April 11th, 2023, and the time is now 6 p.m. As always, I want to remind everyone of our rules of civility and decorum. Officials must first be addressed by the chair and not interrupt a speaker. Public comments must be addressed to the board as a whole and not to any individual on the dais or in the audience. Personal attacks, insults, and similar behaviors are strictly prohibited. Disruptive behaviors from the audience are likewise prohibited, so please govern yourselves accordingly. We're going to begin this evening with an invocation by Board Member Hay, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance. Let's all stand for the invocation and Pledge of Allegiance.
Let us pray. Father, we're grateful for this day. We ask a special blessing on the CRA board. We ask that you take us both by the handlebars of our minds as we make decisions that will affect this great city. Bless this board, bless our executive director, her staff, our department offices, as well as this audience. We thank you for a new beginning. We pray that we will continue to be able to complete those projects that we have started, and that you would be in the midst of those that we are contemplating. Father, we give you all the honor and we give you all the praise. Help us to do the job that we were elected to do and appointed to do. We thank you for the leadership that we have in Boynton. Bless our city manager and his staff. Let us be the great city that you would have Boynton Beach to be. We ask it all in our Savior's name, we pray. Let every heart say amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you, everybody. Clerk, if you could please begin the roll call.
Chair Ty Panserga.
Here.
Vice Chair Thomas Turkin.
Present.
Board Member Angela Cruz.
Present.
Board Member Woodrow Hay.
Present.
Board Member Amy Kelly.
Here.
Chair, you have a quorum.
Thank you. Moving on to agenda approval, additions, deletions, corrections to the agenda. There are no amendments for myself. Let's begin on my right side with Board Member Cruz, followed by Vice Chair Turkin. Board Member Cruz.
I have no disclosures at this time or amendments.
All right. Anything from Vice Chair?
Negative.
Board Member Hay?
No.
All right. Board Member Kelly?
No.
Seeing nothing else, may I have a motion to approve the agenda as presented?
So moved.
Second.
I didn't know if you wanted to hear anything under number 14, any of the CRA projects first, just to, in case if there's staff that's involved that they can be heard, and then.
That is an excellent reminder. Thank you, Executive Director. So let me ask my colleagues, is there anything under 14 that you would like to hear from? Of course, we will have our update from Mr. Tack, our assistant director, but how many of you would like to hear 14A or B? If not, we can relieve staff.
I would like to hear 14C.
14C, that's the MLK update. What about 14A or B?
14A.
Yeah.
14A?
Yeah, it's been a while since we've gotten an update on.
All right, what about B? Would you like to hear? You're not? Okay. That was the no? All right, so with that, we are going to remove 14A from the agenda. Let me ask that again. May I have a motion to approve the agenda as amended? This is again removing 14B.
So moved as amended.
Okay, there's a motion and there's a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed say no. The ayes have it. The agenda is amended. We're moving on now to legal. I'm going to turn to our counsel, Ms. Rosmel. I believe you have an update on Live Local Act.
I do. Good evening, Board Chair and Board members. Just wanted to bring to your attention that the Live Local Act has passed. I know you all are generally aware of that. It has limited change here for the CRA, although it is likely to lead to more development in the city, or at least opens up that possibility in commercial and industrial areas. So I wanted to make sure you all were aware. There are a few provisions that are specific to dependent special districts within the city's boundaries, which is us here at the CRA. One of those changes will require the CRA to publish a list of land to which it holds fee simple title and which could be used for the development of affordable housing. That list will be provided by the CRA to the city, and it will be published on the website pursuant to the new law. And the other thing that this law does that's particularly relevant to the CRA is it talks about different methods of using city land to provide affordable housing. New in particular that I wanted to draw your attention to is the ability to take land that is currently held by the CRA and provide long-term leases for the development of affordable housing, and also offer land for sale and use the proceeds of that to provide various mechanisms of affordable housing. Those are really sort of the biggest updates for the CRA in particular. I'm happy to answer other questions you may have about it, although I think most of that is probably before you more at the city. And if you'd like a full explanation of what's in this act, I'm happy to work one of those up and provide it to you all at the next meeting.
Thank you for that. If you could briefly just elaborate, there was one thing I didn't fully understand. You had mentioned city CRA owned properties and long-term leases.
Sure. So one of the sections that has been revised, and it provides that the properties that are identified in the list that has to be published, it says that those properties may be used for affordable housing through long-term land leases requiring the development and maintenance of affordable housing. So in other words, the CRA would have the ability to enter into, rather than a land sale, a long-term lease to provide for development of affordable housing. So it's just another option that has become, to the extent that it wasn't available, it's now explicitly available under the statute for special districts under this.
All right. Board Member Cruz.
Are there any exceptions to this? For example, when I read the bill, one of the things that I was kind of caught my eye most importantly was the area where Senate Bill 102 precludes any local governments from really making any decisions in regard to density or height for new developments going forward, effective, I think it's July 1st.
Right, so that's really more of a question to be addressed by the city, so I don't want to lead you all into a discussion here. There are some exceptions to the new provisions that have happened. I mean, in general, I can say what this law does related to the concept that you're talking about is it permits affordable housing to be developed in areas that are zoned commercial and industrial, as long as it meets certain standards, and it requires for those to be approved administratively. Those developments would be subject to certain regulations within the city. Again, I don't want to get too far into that. There are some exceptions to that as well, but in terms of what we're talking about here tonight, there are no exceptions to what can be listed, and then the affordable housing development, it doesn't call for land that's not appropriate for that, so all the land on that list could be used for that purpose.
Board Member Cruz, I appreciate you bringing that up. That is a question that I also had, and I think we'll have that discussion further at the City Commission meeting. Matters of height and density and such are on the purview of the City Commission.
And if you know the board would like to provide direction, I'd be happy to work with your city attorney and see if we could work you up a joint presentation or memorandum.
I would love that.
Okay.
Yes.
All right, I'll reach out to your city attorney's office and we'll get something together for you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Board Member Kelly.
Yeah, no, I was just, you know, when I was having my agenda review, this was brought up that it was going to happen, and I feel like we're all kind of spinning our wheels. But thank you, Catherine, for at least coming in and speaking about these two things. But you know, we have city staff working on this and city attorneys working on this and potential workshops and all this stuff going on. And there really is a lot of overlap. And so I would love for you to work with city staff so that we don't have multiple people doing the same work, because that's really not productive for anyone. So that, you know, that would be my goal, is that the city would, you know, because this is, you know, most of the things that this affects are citywide, that they would, you know, take the lead on it. And then obviously, Catherine, you know, how it affects the CRA, you know, then you would be involved as well. But that's kind of my vision of that, so that we don't have multiple people doing the same work and we're paying the legal fees on right. all of this. So that's, you know, so those are my thoughts, as, you know, we've been talking a lot with city staff about workshops and doing, you know, stuff that, so that we're all on the same page all at the same time, and we're not all getting different information at different times. So.
Couldn't agree more. Anything else from my colleagues for council? All right. Thank you so much. We're now moving on to informational items and disclosures by board members and CRA staff. Disclosures of conflict, contacts, and relationships for items presented to the CRA board on the agenda. I'll begin on my left this time with board member Kelly.
Do not have any disclosures except just that I've gotten quite a few emails with regard to the One Ocean project. So all right. I wanted to just put that on the record, but no other items. Thank you.
Board member.
I don't have any disclosures at this time.
All right. As for myself, I did speak with Bonnie Miskell regarding 12D, and I also received a handful of emails for that item as well. Vice Chair.
I've spoken with the residents in my district in regards to 12D. And that is it for that item.
I have no disclosures for this meeting.
All right. Thank you, everyone. We're now moving on to announcements and awards. Item 8A, Boyne Beach CRA 2021 through 2022 fiscal, financial and annual report.
Good evening, Board. Renee Rosario, social media and communications specialist for the Boynton Beach CRA. The CRA is proud to announce that its fiscal year 2021-2022 annual report containing the annual audit was mailed to all required officials and taxing authorities on March 24th, 2023, and posted on the Boynton Beach CRA's website in accordance with Florida state statutes. 200 hard copies are currently printed for distribution, and an electronic copy in PDF format can also be downloaded from the Boynton Beach CRA's website, or you can scan the code on the front cover and get an electronic copy that way. If you have any questions, please let me know.
Thank you. Any questions for my colleagues? Seeing none, thank you so much. All right. We're now moving on to public comments. This is the portion of the agenda for items that are not on the agenda. Before we proceed with public comments, I want to remind everybody, as always, it is 3 minutes per person. Comments must be addressed to the board as a whole and not to any individual on the dais or in the audience. Personal attacks and such are strictly prohibited. After the last person in the chamber has spoken, we will proceed with those online. And then we will inform all those online when you have 30 seconds remaining. Let's begin. If you would like to speak on any non-agenda items, please approach the podium now. All right. Seeing
Mayor. Yes. Are we going to have public comment on 12D?
Because absolutely.
Okay. I just want to make sure.
For every single item, we will have public comment. So, yes. Board.
I'm sorry.
It's all good. Let's proceed now to online. Mani, is there anybody online with their digital hands raised?
There are no hands raised at this time.
Ms. Kerfman. All right, public comments are now closed. We're going to move on to consent agenda. Are there any items under consent that my colleagues would like to pull? Hearing none, may have a motion to approve the consent agenda.
So moved.
There is a motion and a second.
With discussion, can I ask a...
Absolutely.
Can we do it with discussion? I wanted to just ask you with regard to 10E, is this, you were going to provide an update. Did they get certificate of occupancy? Where are they?
No, they do need the 60 day.
Okay. Yes. Perfect. Thank you.
All right. No, thank you, board member. We have a motion and a second for the consent agenda. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed say no. The ayes have it. The consent agenda has now been approved. We're moving on to 12, old business, beginning with 12A, quarterly progress report from BBQOZ LLC for the 150 North Federal Highway mixed-use project, also known as The Piers. I was told that we will have Camissa Collins, Vice President of Development, and that she'll be joining us virtually. Ms. Kerfman, is she available?
Ms. Collins, you are self-muted. Go ahead and speak, please.
Thank you. Good evening, Mayor, Vice Chair, and board members. I am Camissa Collins, VP of Development over at Affiliated. The project hasn't had any significant changes since the last time we met. We are moving forward with our plans and addressing our conditions of approval at this time, and we will be submitting for permits in the summer. And that's really, you know, the only update that I have at this time. And yeah, they have a agenda or a report posted as well. Let me know if you have any questions.
Thank you, Ms. Collins. Any questions from my colleagues to Ms. Collins? All right. I guess that's it. Thank you so much for the update.
Thank you for the report here.
That shows you. Thank you so much.
Have a good evening, everyone.
Have a good evening. Moving on to 12B, consideration of approval of 500 Ocean performance audit for year ending December 31st, 2022 for compliance with the direct incentive funding agreement. I'm going to turn now to our executive director to introduce the item.
Yes, good evening, Chair, board members, and members of the public. Tweesha for the record. This item is before you because we've entered into a DIFA, a direct incentive funding agreement with Lasessa Corporation back in 2015. As part of the agreement, there is some TIF funding that gets to be returned to the developer. We are in year four. Under the agreement, they get 75% of the paid tax TIF ad valorem dollars. That will equate to $578,087 for this past fiscal year. We've received proof of their audit for any of the obligations they need to fulfill for that development. We also have proof that the taxes were paid. And this is consistent with what we've been issuing in the past year one through three. So approval of this will allow us to cut the, to release the payment back to the developer, which is a new new owner, Avanti. So.
All right, thank you. And Council, this is final action, so I believe we do need public comment on this item. All right. Questions or comments from my colleagues or staff on this item? Seeing none, we'll proceed to public comment. As if you would like to speak on this item, now would be the time to approach the podium. Again, this is item 12B. This is for the performance audit and compliance with the direct incentive funding agreement for 500 Ocean. All right, seeing no one in the audience, is there anybody online, Ms. Karfman?
No hands are raised.
All right, public comments on this item are now closed. Hearing nothing else from my colleagues, may I have a motion to approve 12B?
So move.
I heard a motion from Vice Chair Turkin. I heard a second from Board Member Hay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed say no. The ayes have it. The motion passes unanimously. We're now moving on to item 12C. Discussion and consideration of lease with the USPS to remain at the CRA-owned property located at 217 North Seacrest Boulevard. Executive Director?
Yes. As a brief overview of this project, this is the current post office located at 217 North Seacrest Boulevard. In 2020, we entered in a purchase and development agreement to purchase the property. As part of that, the owner is supposed to deliver this unoccupied. However, we know that the post office needs time to relocate and find a new location. We were willing to close on the property on February 1st and have the post office as a holdover tenant. What you're looking before you now is really a new lease with the post office. The current the previous rate was $10.40. The CRA staff has done a lease analysis and it states that we can get $25 per square foot. And the post office is in agreement with that. The lease agreement has been reviewed by our attorney and it's before you for consideration. So we'll be getting a little more than what the previous owner has, just for, if anything, the maintenance and repair of that building. The building is older. And we know there's obligations that we have as a landlord to do so. So the term of the lease is 1 year. The rent is $180,120. And there's a clause that the USPS can terminate with 90-day written notice. So, but we know that we're working with them to locate them because it's important to have a eastern location for our Boynton residents.
Thank you. I'll begin now on my right, Board Member Cruz, if you have any questions or comments on this item.
No, just thank you to Tui, our executive director, for being on top of this and making sure that we get the right amount for this property. And, you know, we went through it during our agenda review, so I don't have any further comments right now.
Vice Chair?
Nope, I share the same sentiment with Board Member Cruz.
Board Member Hay.
That was outstanding to be able to go from 10.40 to 25. But would you share a little more how that was, we were able to do that? Was it basically because of the law, or can you share with us?
Yeah, the post office has always was willing to pay market rate. We don't know what that is with the building, the size, and then the current condition of that. So the way to do it is just get a market analysis of what you can get based on that. So really, it's simple. It's our staff that's, you know, that's done the work. I'm just here to present it. But our staff did a wonderful job in protecting the public interest. So, and it's easy for two government entities to work together. So
excellent. Excellent. Nice. Thank you.
Good. Board Member Kelly.
I do have a couple of questions. I was reviewing the previous lease, and I'm missing it, but I didn't see anything as far as insurance that has to be held on the property. Is that our responsibility now as the owners, or are we requiring the post office to have any sort of rider as well?
We are obligated for a lot of the insurance. We just recently did a roof inspection, like any of our other projects that we own. We do make sure that we have, all things in place for that. So yeah, it's our obligation.
Okay. So in addition to Wynn, though, for premise liability, for general liability, we carry that policy.
Yes. And they still have to have their, you know, whatever the federal government for their facilities, they normally will do as well. But okay, for the building itself, we are the landlord. So we have to, we also have to maintain it like we do any other, you know, right, facility. Okay.
And then my other question has to, so it's a 1-year lease, and if we have not, or they have not been able to secure a new facility by then, what is then their protection and our protection moving forward? Are there extensions built in? I didn't see that within what the attachments, or maybe, like I said, there was a lot, so yeah, maybe I missed it. Yeah. But what's the extension?
They can always come to the board anywhere between now and the expiration to ask for an extension. We will also keep you updated on that. So our goal is to try to get them into their new facility as soon as possible. They still have to issue public notices to the public about their carrier service being relocated elsewhere. So they have federal regulations that they need to do. And we'll ask for a copy of that. And I can certainly, you know, give you that information as a heads up. I'm sure they will write to the mayor to inform him of such. So they have certain requirements to vacate the current premise. They'll have to do their due diligence throughout, but we will try to keep you informed of the process as we look for the 411 site, you know, to look at that as a redevelopment site for the new retail post office.
Right. But there's no extensions like built into this?
No.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Anything else from my colleagues? I'll turn this item now for public comment. If you would like to speak on this consideration of a 1-year lease with the USPS to remain at the site, now would be the time to approach the podium. Seeing none, Ms. Kerfman, is there anybody online?
No hands are raised.
All right. Public comments on this item are now closed. If there's nothing else from my colleagues, I'd like a motion to approve item 12C. This is for the 1-year lease with USPS to remain at the CRA-owned property located at 217 North Seacrest Boulevard.
Motion to approve.
We have a motion from Board Member Cruz and a second from Board Member Kelly. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed say no. The ayes have it. The motion passes unanimously. We now turn to item 12D, discussion and consideration of a 1-year extension request of the construction of a public plaza per the purchase and development agreement with Ocean One Boynton LLC for the Ocean One project. I'm going to turn to our executive director to introduce the item, and then I'll turn now, follow after that, to their representative. Ms.
Motion Pistole. To remove from table.
Oh, that's correct. This was previously tabled. Thank you, Board Member Hay. We have a motion to remove from the table as well as a second. All those in favor to remove from the table say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed say no. The ayes have it. The item has been removed from the table. Executive Director.
Yes. For the benefit of the audience, I'll go through a really brief. This has got a pretty long and colorful history. The site is located at the southeast corner of Federal Highway and Boynton Beach Boulevard Extension. This was actually, this is called the Ocean One property in our files. The CRA had entered into a purchase and development agreement with One Ocean Boynton back in January 2018. The transfer of land and property ownership occurred on February 24, 2018. The Ocean One mixed-use project received site plan approval from the city on April 17, 2017. On January 5th, 2021, the CRA approved a letter from the developer's attorney notifying the board regarding the TIF, the TRFA, the Tax Increment Revenue Financing Agreement, the expiration of such. You can see that in attachment 3 through 5, which acknowledged by the CRA board that the termination of that agreement was acknowledged. In addition to the TRFA, so there's two. There's the purchase and development agreement, and then there's a TRFA agreement seeking financing of the TIF dollars. The developers also was seeking a 6-month extension from the board for the commencement of the public plaza. Again, this 0.5 acre of land to the north of the property was always envisioned to be part of the mixed-use project, and as a requirement, if the development didn't commence development, that a public plaza be built there. So again, once fast forward, the TRFA has been terminated, there remains really the purchase and development agreement. Back in September 7th, 2021, there was a letter updating the status of the permit application. And we also received a letter in October indicating that there should be some in lieu of fee to pay for the cost of the public plaza. Once again, in October 2021, the board has negotiated, instead of the in-lieu fee exchange, there were options. The option was to pay $20,000 for a 2-year extension to March 9th of this year, to receive a building permit for the public plaza, to provide construction status every 6 months, and a payment of no less than $100,000 for the release of the condition or declaration of default. The board and the property owner has reached an agreement November 9th to have a 1-year extension to the building for the building permit March 9th, 2023 for the public plaza to have permits for the previous approved site plan, or to have a permit for the new site plan consisting of the entire site, or the commencement of construction with the public plaza. We received on January of this year a letter from Ms. Minskel asking for a 1-year extension. The board tabled the item because the deadline of March 9th hasn't passed. February was when we received the letter. No, sorry, January. We heard it in February, and the board decided to table it for this meeting. So before you is a request for an extension. Ms. Cole is here. If there's any other things, any other items you'd like to ask or fill in for you. I'm here for other questions. So right now, the current project is being scheduled for the meeting of April 18th for City Commission for the site plan approval and any other design appeals that is needed for the city to consider. That is before the City Commission. What we have before us now is just the extension request, correct?
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Strutt. We're going to turn now to Ms. Minskel.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Bonnie Minskel. I'm here on behalf of the new owner. So, and staff did a great job of giving you the history. There is a lot of history related to this particular block, and I won't go through that again. But I'm happy to report that we've gone through the Planning and Development Board, and they are recommending support of the site plan, the new site plan, and we are on the City Commission agenda for next week to go over that with the City Commission. Which we hope you'll be happy with. Its staff also recommended it in favor of that particular plan. We do need to obtain permits. We need enough time to get permits. So we're still seeking an extension so that we can get building permits. But at this point, we've made great progress. We've gotten through Planning and Development Board, and next week we'll be seeing you again sitting as a City Commission for approval of the new site plan. And as soon as that plan is approved, my client will engage all of the consultants that they need to do their construction drawings, the engineering of the project, and get those CDs ultimately into the building department, where we are sure that we'll be taken care of very nicely, and that we'll expedite this to the extent that we possibly can. But we do need the time to get the building permit at this point, and we are just about there as far as the approval is concerned. And I'm happy to answer any other questions that you may have.
All right, thank you for that. For now, are there any questions or comments for Ms. Miskell or Ms. Schutt from my colleagues here on the board? All right, so seeing none for now, let's turn now to public audience. Let's hear any public comments on this item. If you are here to speak on it, now's the time to approach the podium. After we've concluded with the last person in the chambers, we will go to those online, and that will be the end of when we will take digital hands raised. As always, each person has 3 minutes. Please state your name for the record and begin when you are ready.
Yvonne Scovron, 350 North Federal Highway, Boynton Beach, apartment 1405. So I have a few comments, but they're in no particular order. Regarding the extension, we keep extending. You know, we gave this land really for a measly $1. This land is now worth at least 1.7 million. I think that going for an extension, we should ask for penalties or some fee for keep extending. One of my other questions is yes, it's gone through the planning board and it's going to come to the commissioners next week. I personally, as a resident, have some questions on that, but I presume it will be next week I need to bring those up. But I want to know, do they have financing in place? Because if they don't have financing, why are we going for an extension? Do we know if they have financing? At this point of the game, they should have secured some kind of financing. As I said, I think we keep going, it keeps being transferred from one developer to a new developer, and the city is just keep saying, yes, we'll give you another extension. When is enough is enough? And when can we have a penalty or some kind of, yes, you can have an extension, but not for a measly 20,000. That's for the cost of the project. That doesn't make sense. We need to have a substantial amount. We gave them a good piece of land, and we need to make it viable that they move forward and not keep asking for extensions. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, next person.
Hello, my name is Vanessa Belmonte. My address is 100 Northeast 6th Street, apartment 607 in Boynton Beach. I am here as a Boynton Beach native and a concerned citizen speaking up against the extension request and also against the density increase of the Ocean One project. I personally and professionally have not seen a community thrive because of quantity. It's truly about quality of life, quality of citizens, schools, mobility, green space, and the value of the community in general. There are already three huge developments happening in this area, and we ask that you please weigh the quality that this project will bring to the citizens. We also ask that you pause this project and hold a community workshop instead to better understand what's best for the community. Ocean One will put a strain on our neighborhood, specifically the parking and accessibility to the Boynton Beach Marina. It's clear the new developer is neglectful after defaulting numerous agreements and deadlines set by the CRA, even after the CRA sold them this land. The main reason is really lack of parking, overall congestion, and we just ask you to take the time to really weigh what's best for the citizens, what's best for the community, and how much parking and accessibility is really left over after yet another development in that area. So thank you, commissioners and mayor. Please vote against the extension request in order to help us maintain the integrity, accessibility, and charm of Marina Village area for the local residents and visitors. And more so, we ask you to hold a community workshop to please weigh the future of this project. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker. And we do have two podiums if anybody else wants to get up.
Hi, Linda Cross, 625 Casa Loma Boulevard, Unit 601. There's two issues that I have. First of all, I've been involved with dealing with this property since 2017. extension after extension after extension, nothing happening. This property that is across from the Casa Costa property that's at the corner of Boynton Beach Boulevard and Federal Highway is worth probably over $1 million by now. I remember when it was torn down because it was torn, that there was a hotel on that property that was torn down to, in order to build Marina Village and to extend Boynton Beach Boulevard. That property is what makes this whole project viable. And the only thing that's going to make that area viable is additional parking. And right now, there is an incredible parking shortage at that area. And the area was had a parking shortage at the time. And I think if you look back in the records, you'll see there was at least 100 spaces underparked when even Marina Village was built. Marina Village did not get any tax incentive funding for the developer at the time. Casa Costa did. Marina Village did not. I believe that at the time, you can look back and there was at least 100 spaces underparked. There's 120 spaces at Marina Village that currently are for public parking, that the CRA has the rights to those parking spaces. And every day there are somewhere in the neighborhood of 20 parkers per hour turned around because the parking garage is full. So if you allow this project to go forward without another, if you take 20 spaces per hour during the day, at least another 100 spaces of public parking, you are making a huge mistake in terms of what's happening down in that marina. It's wonderful down there, except that you've got all the boats, the Sea Mist, Banana Boat, Two Georges, and all the other retail spaces that are down there. Casa Costa doesn't have public parking, and so consequently, the parking is a huge issue. And then when the bridge goes up on Ocean Avenue, it is a tremendous traffic jam that people block the box at Federal Highway and Ocean Avenue, and it's a tremendous problem. So I really think you need to, number one, it's enough extensions for these folks. They've asked for extension after extension after extension, and that property should never have been added to this project until they put the shovel into the ground, which is what I told you back in 2017. But that got rejected. You let them have that property. But now you need to reject this proposal. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, next speaker, please state your name for the record.
My name is Martin Clauber. I live in Marina Village. For 30 years, as a government official, it was my job to determine the public interest issues of land development. What is the public interest issue of this proposed development? The base public interest issue is parking and traffic. I've asked my fellow residents, not one time has any representative of the developer offered to meet with us. Through the entire extension and development process. So I have a proposal which has worked for 15 years. I propose that as a condition, if there is an extension, that this applicant enters into what is called a transportation management agreement. After having met with representatives of the CRA and the neighborhood to determine how you mitigate the traffic impact of this proposed development and to put that in binding writing as a condition of the approval of this development. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. All right, next speaker.
Hi.
Hi.
My name is Eileen. Wait, am I the right one? I'm not sure.
Either one is fine.
Okay. My name is Eileen Brucolari, and I live 700 East Boynton Beach Boulevard in Marina Village, apartment 1101. I have, as a member of the board, we've put together a letter that I emailed earlier this week. Did you all get it? Because I have copies here if you haven't seen it.
Okay. Yes, it's on our desk.
Okay, good. Okay, I also have another handout that I'll show you. So I just wanted to, you've seen what our points are. It's really the parking is, we know that the land's going to be developed. We're not here to stop development. We know that something's going to be put there. There'll be housing, which is needed. But the parking is a huge issue in the marina. The Two Georges restaurant and the Banana Boat, people park in our garage from those two establishments, as well as the boats. And as well as the beach. The beach parking is not adequate. People are parking in our garage and walking across the bridge. And so we are, you've heard Linda speak earlier about how slammed we are with the parking. And I just want to say that we're really at a breaking point and not sure how we can manage. This season was, we were lucky that nobody got hit in walking through the garage to get to their car, and there were other cars coming in and going out. So it was very bad. So I just wanted to urge you to use your half acre of land to demand that the developer put more parking on that site for the public. We find that of our garage, 120 spaces, approximately 40 or 50 are used for employees first. Employees of the restaurants, employees of all the businesses around there. So there's really not that many spaces even available for the public. The other point I want to make is that the developer has come up with a proposal. One of the, they proposed putting parking on Sixth Court, which is sort of in back of the building. And I wanted to just bring pictures of what Sixth Court looks like. It's barely wide enough now for two-way traffic. So there is no room for parking on this street. So I don't know, can I give this to you to include in the record, or I'm not sure how that works?
To the clerk.
Oh, okay, okay. I'm sorry. I didn't know where. And that's really all I wanted to. I hope that you can use your power to urge more parking on this site for the public. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Next speaker.
Good evening, Harry Woodworth. I live here in Boynton. I just wanted to add the comments on the project. I was at that P&D meeting. I've been to go into those things, sir. I don't know. I lived here 40 years, missed very few of them. That was the biggest smoke and mirror job I ever saw in my life. Traffic engineer got up and said what he had to say. Of course, we're in the exclusion area, so we don't worry about traffic over there. Not that there is any on North Federal. The parking is a sham. They got parking on Federal, folks. Come on, really? Right there where you got to come out of that parking lot, turn right, and somehow go south? Really? How are they going to do that? That was so smoke and mirrors, you can't even believe it. I ask you to look at how the calculations were done. That was pure hoodoo. I mean, there are basic equations you can use, but we've got fancy. We got really creative on the parking. We put cars everywhere, and then we did a calculation that made it look like we had enough. There's no parking over there. There hasn't been parking over there since 2017 when Linda was on the CRA board. This is going to make it. This might be the last chance that we have to get this right over there. I mean, there's people don't go down there now because you can never find a place to park. Parking. Traffic. This concurrency thing, exemption, is just a joke. I mean, somebody's got to start looking at the traffic that comes in and out of these places. This thing, I think, generates thousands of daily trips. Somebody ought to add up the thousands and thousands and thousands. I think it gets close to 10,000 daily trips on the stuff that's been approved and hasn't been CO'd yet. Where the hell are all those cars going to go? Let's start looking at some of this stuff. This project is, the 18th is going to be very entertaining. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, next speaker.
Hello, my name is Michael Minia. I'm an original owner at Marina Village. I'm also on the Marina Village condo and master board. I'm here to represent the residents of Marina Village. Our last board meeting was one of the longest board meetings we've had in the 16 years I've been there, 17 years. And it was all about this project, the parking issues. The parking issues in general get brought up every board meeting, pretty much, about how busy our parking garage is, especially the public portion. there's just not enough parking. I don't want to keep mentioning what everybody else is saying, but out of the 20 an hour that are parking attendants said that they're turning away, that's not counting the other people that are driving by and seeing the lot full sign at the time, because we have lot full signs. We had to add signs outside when the lot's full. That way our residents can still get in through the parking garage to their parking spots. So the public was blocking it, and it's still happening because the attendants still can't keep up with everything that's going on. So we do ask that, you know, the other issue is when we ask how other things got approved, we're always told, oh, well, it was the board with this person, and this person on it. And so we're asking that you guys are the board that does the right thing, so we don't look back when you guys are gone with the problem that we're dealing with based on the decisions you guys made. So we're asking for you guys to make the right decision. So this is the board that we look back on that made the right decisions for that portion of the community. That area is the most happening area in anywhere around here, and it needs the right kind of parking. And we do want something beautiful to be built there, and we want to enjoy it. You know, we can't wait for something to go up there, but it's got to be the right thing, and it's got to be planned properly. So we ask that you deny the density increase, and we ask that you deny the extension, get somebody in who really wants to build something beautiful for this area. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, next speaker.
Rick Dunston, property manager at Marina Village. I'm going to talk about the parking here again. It's a highlight. I'm sure you guys got a bunch of emails from my residents. You kind of blame my mass email on that. There are numerous studies out there for parking and redevelopment. That is an important aspect of transportation planning and urban design. Most developers use these when presenting development options. A couple of these are high cost or free parking by Donald Shoup, parking infrastructures, constraints or opportunities for urban redevelopment by Mark Klein, parking pricing and revenue by Rachel Weinberg and Donald Shoup. The vast majority of these studies were done pre-pandemic. These anticipated a reduction in automobile use throughout the US and the world, with reduction rates of car use between 15% and 30%, depending on what study you reviewed in geographic locations. These stats make great opportunities for developers and local governments to reduce parking needs. Post-pandemic studies are now accounting for how we now view the world, personal time, where we live. A current MIT study has only a 5.1% drop in car ownership in North America by the year 2050. These 3 and 4 trips will be taken, continued by car in the year 2050s. The cars we take will change. The overall ownership of cars will not. Ford Future Trends and GM has also done several studies regarding this. Ford recently did a Harris poll. I can't imagine life without my own automobile. 76% of global owners agreed with that statement. Because of the pandemic, I am less likely to take a subway, ride a train, travel by airplane, use ride sharing service or a taxi or carpool. I use my vehicle. How we use our vehicles is changing. Many of them are using your vehicles, as now is the time to relax and get away. Access to ownership, which do you prefer? There's a lot of talk about ride sharing and these types of cars, and a lot of talk with Generation Z and X, okay? 1 in 4 Gen Zers say if the costs are comparable, they'll choose car sharing services that provides access to many different vehicles over owning a vehicle. 1 in 4 of Gen Zers. The paradigm has shifted. So I do ask the board take a look at it and make the decisions. Automakers are making decisions now on autos. Ooh, overtime. Anyways, please leave the legacy to where you guys, where years from now, we could all say we made the correct decisions, especially regarding the future development. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, next speaker.
Good evening. My name is Terrence Cahill, and I live at 625 Casaloma. I'm going to be kind of brief. I'm not going to go back over all the stuff you've already heard, because it's the same stuff we've been talking about for many years. It is not pleasant, it is not easy, and it's not safe. The conditions that we have today in parts of our property. What I'm going to call on you as our commissioners, as our representatives, to remember what you said at the beginning of the meeting. You're here to represent the community. I want to suggest to you, this is your community, not the developer, not the investor. Your community is the people living in the neighborhood. These are the people that need you. We need you to protect us, not to protect somebody's wallet, not to protect somebody's dollars. We need you to protect us, to look at the community and see what you're developing. Over the years, there have been a number of real bad decisions made from this chamber, not by you, I'm saying, but by this chamber. And each time that was done, there was no thought to what it was having to the community. It was either the bottom line for the dollar or for some other reason, but it was not about the community. Please, as everyone has said, think of the community tonight. Think of what you're doing to the community and whether or not it's in their best interest and not just in someone else's. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Any other in-person public comment speaker? This is our last call. I see one more person in person, and then we'll go to online.
My name is Maria Voloshin. For 9 years, I live in Marina Village. My address 700 East Boynton Beach Boulevard, apartment 404. For last 9 years, I see that population of our city dramatically increased, and no secret for anybody. And also, a lot was done for the community, I think, because city much nicer and better than 9 years ago. So thank you for this. But what I wanted to say that the area where the new development supposed to be is the area where every year we have number of celebration for parade. Actually, this is the area that enjoyed by the old city of Boynton Beach. And I think it's not only us that we're lucky to buy apartment and live close to the ocean, but all city supposed to enjoy this area.
Can anyone hear me? The feed just dropped. Jennifer, are you still?
Hello. I can't hear anything. Can you guys hear me? Come on, man. Seriously. I don't know if anybody can hear me. I'm muted. Yes, I don't know if anybody can hear me, but I am in 100% agreement with everybody who has spoken. I am, my name is Jason Mora. I am at 625 Casa Loma Boulevard. As I said, 100% in agreement what everyone has been talking about with the parking and everything else. It's just, it's a miracle that somebody hasn't been hit in our garage so far. The land that was donated or basically donated to the builder has definitely got to be parking, something developed there for parking. We want to see something there, but it has to be something that can work with our community as well. So please do what you can to make that happen for us. Thank you.